Join us for the WLJC Fall Telethon, which begins Monday, October 24th at 7 p.m. We invite you to be a part of this ministry that is reaching around the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Join us each evening to hear live gospel music as we worship God in song and truth. Our guest hosts and pastors will be here to read your pledges and pray for you. We want to thank you for your prayers and financial support of this ministry. Together, we will minister to God's people and spread the gospel over the airwaves. WLJC can reach those who cannot or will not attend church. For some people, WLJC may be their only opportunity to hear the gospel. Your donation can make a difference. The WLJC Fall Telethon is live October 24th through November 5th from 7 to 10 p.m. nightly. Pledge now and support the WLJC ministry. 606-464-3600 or 859-469-7482, or go to WLJC.com and click donate. Thank you for all your support. May God bless you.
WLJC welcomes you to have church with us for the next 90 minutes during the hour of harvest. Call in your prayer request or praise report now. The WLJC prayer team is standing by to talk and pray with you. We have some very special musical guests here this evening to share in song the good news of the gospel. So sit back, relax, sing along, and join in with us as we pray for you and the needs of all our viewing audience. Hour of Harvest is touching countless souls from the Appalachian Mountains to the Bluegrass region, across the nation, and around the world. Live from our studios in Beattyville, Kentucky, here is your host of the Hour of Harvest, Margaret Drake.
Good evening, and welcome to our first night of our fall revival. We are here to tell you about Jesus, and I know that some of you are rejoicing and praying with us because that we are here for this purpose. And to start off our revival tonight, one of my staff here tonight, Travis, he prayed and led a person to the Lord that called a while ago, Kaylee Wilson, and she called and accepted the Lord as her personal Savior. So that's our first salvation. So that is great to start with. And I sure appreciate my staff that can pray with people and help them, because, you know, sometimes the staff is working when some of us is not here. And so I'm glad they know how to pray and to lead someone to the Lord. And, you know, Jesus said to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, the whole human race. And that's what we're doing at WLJC through the internet and through other means, and so Dish Direct and so forth. And so we hope that you'll be in that number with us here tonight. We have some great guests, some people that have been praying for the service, and we're going to see a move of God, we know.
Amen.
Because God is always with us. He's with you. And so we're going to see some things really turn around.
Amen.
We have Pastor, Brother
Winston McClurg.
Winston McClurg, and also
Joe Klein
with us. And so they're going to greet you, and then we're going to have about 30 minutes of music. They brought some of their choir, and then these two fellas are going to minister the word to you. And you just stay tuned, because I know that we're going to hear something good. So, Brother Winston, how are you tonight?
Praise the Lord. Thank God I'm still saved. And we just came back from a camp meeting in Prairie Stones in Cleveland, Tennessee. Heard some wonderful preaching, prophecy conference, and this thing's about to wind up. But I've got good news for you. There is a Joel revival coming, and it's the latter rain's going to be greater than the former. You couldn't hardly think that it could be greater than Pentecost when Peter preached and about 3,000 souls got saved. But up near Bluefield, West Virginia, 3,700, I reckon, at this time. Logan, about 3,000. And then in North Carolina, they had some Baptist brothers was praying, started a revival. little church wasn't too big. They got 75 saved. They set a 5,000-seat tent right beside the church, and they tell me they can't get them under the tent. Tell me God's not working. Mm-hmm. You've been looking in the, you've been fishing in the wrong pond.
Mm-hmm. All right. Joe?
Yes, Sister Margaret, thank you for another opportunity to come here and be with you all. And, we see several people on the streets of Moorhead, and we get to talk to them, and they say, hey, you guys have been on WLJC, or are you getting ready to go back? And I said, yes, we are. And said, we just love that station. We love what the Word of God's being preached and everything that's being done, and we just count it a blessing and to come down here and just be with you all. I just tell everybody what good people you are down here, and what a light you are, in that you're shining throughout not only our community, but this is reaching the world. And this is what we need. Sometimes we think we might be a little flicker, but you know what? A flicker may be all somebody needs, is to see that light, because as the Word of God sometimes describes darkness, darkness is not just the absence of light. Darkness is also representative of sin. And we've got a world that's filled with that. And if they can just see a little light, then I know that they're seeing it here with WLJC. And if I'm not careful, I'll go ahead and get to preaching, but yeah. I'll let you go ahead and we'll get the singing going.
All right. Well, we want to have a word of prayer before we get started, because a lot of you expect us to, and you join with us, and that's what makes it so important. So, you, Brother Joe, would you lead us in a prayer for the service?
I sure will. Gracious Father, Lord, we come before you this evening, just thanking you so much for being there. And Lord, we know that you hear us when we call. And Father, as the words being brought forth through song here in just a few minutes, Lord, let it minister to hearts. And when the word's being preached, Lord, we know the ground's going to be fouled up. It's going to be broken up to where it's going to be received. And Father, you know who's going to be watching tonight, and you know who's going to be touched tonight. And we've already got the report that there's rejoicing in heaven, because there's a soul that's already been saved in this revival. Lord, bless this revival. Bless everyone that speaks, everyone that sings, everything that's said and done. And Lord, Sister Margaret and all this staff, Lord, just bless them tremendously as they're bringing people into the kingdom. And Father, we thank you and we praise you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right. We are going to have some good music. We have the House of Prayer Singers from Moorhead, Kentucky, and they do know how to sing. So we're going to go over and listen to about 30 minutes, and then that's going to give the two ministers here plenty of time to share with us. Because during revival here, we always spend more time with the preachers than the singing. But we want to first enjoy all this good music, so let's welcome the House of Prayer Singers right now.
We feel it a count and a privilege to be able to be here and open up the first night of the revival. So just get in and have church with us, because we feel like this is a revival. Yes, we're going to sing Days of Elijah. And you know, we are living in the Days of Elijah time. Elijah, God spoke to him and told him to stand up and be for God. And that's what we need to do as children of God, is to stand up and be for God and let the world know that God is not dead. He is still alive.
Amen.
And
Amen.
Still in Thank control you, Jesus. Of everything that's going on.
Thank you.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, the righteous are being restored. witnessing the handwriting on the wall. And to me, this is, I felt like the Lord spoke to me when I saw this song. He said, this is an end day song. And you know, it just tells about the time that the king was throwing a big feast and a big party. Ain't that what's going on? And you know, he didn't realize, but he looked over and in the light from the candle, he saw a fingers of a man's hand writing on the wall. But he couldn't tell what it was. He had to get Daniel, a man of God, to come in and tell him what the writing was. And it was to tell him his kingdom was going to fall, and he was weighed in the balance and found wanting. Just listen to the words of this song. The king set a feast for a banquet. He invited all his men to come in. But he didn't know before the night was over that the kingdom that he held would pass away. As the crowd began to roar in a drunken slumber, a worried look soon took his smile away. And as he looked, he said, behold, I see a finger, and it's writing something on the wall today. America has strayed so far away. We don't know how to worship. We've forgotten how to pray. But there's still hope, my friend, while on this earth we trod. Let's seek out the old path. Let's turn back to God.
I want to send this program out to our whole church audience that we have at the House of Prayer and everywhere else. I've got people all over the place saying, give us a prayer request. So this song or name, you know, request the song to them. So I'll get my tongue out of my eye. And this goes out to all of you that's asked any of us to send out a song. This is your songs.
All right. I want to thank each person that stops me and mentions this when we're on here. And I want to thank each one of you and let you know that we don't never take that for granted. We do appreciate you when you stop us in the grocery store and Walmart and mention it. We really, really, truly do appreciate you. And I want to send this out to a lot of my old school buddies I've run onto out at Walmart that stopped me. And you know who you are. And, you know, life just keeps throwing stuff at you. But you got to roll with the punches, you know. God said to take up your cross daily and follow him. So we have to keep hanging on. And I hope I don't mess the words up on this song because it's pretty well known. I'm real notorious for that. Abraham prayed for the day God would send him a son. Precious Isaac was his name, the greatest gift he'd ever known. But then one day, who would have dreamed that God would say, you've got to give him to me. And on this mountain, you must prove that it's you and Isaac, or it's me and you. And when I lay Isaac down with a broken heart, but my father's proud. And on this altar where he lay, it wasn't Isaac he wanted, he wanted me. Now most of us, I dare to say, have an Isaac that's in God's way. But on this mountain, you must prove whether it's you and Isaac, or it's me and you. And as I lay my Isaac down with the broken heart, but my father's proud. And on this altar where he lays, it wasn't Isaac he wanted me. You know, we've all got problems. We're all human. We're all just alike. So don't think that this thing you're going through is unique just to you, but we've all went through it too. And we will go through other things too down the road. But like I said, if they done it to Jesus, they're going to do it to you. So don't be shocked. And the devil, he doesn't take a break. He's going to come right after you and wherever you are, especially if you try to serve the Lord. If you try to serve the Lord, he will come after you. And he will turn you around and around and spin you in every direction. But you know what? You get up and you focus on the cross. You focus on Jesus. And his blood will take you through.
Well, a few weeks ago we were here at WLJC and I had this song in my head. I was going to sing When the Roll Is Called Up Yonder. But I told Francie I was singing another song. So I had these two songs in my head I had said. So I thought, you know, I just kind of mumbled through that because it's Francie's fault. She did the wrong thing. But anyway, it's working good. Listen, we had homecoming right after that. And we had a ton of people at our church. 300 showed up. Gerald Crabb was there to sing and preach. And we were feeding everybody afterwards. And some guy looked at me and said, oh, I know you. You're the lady with two songs in your head. Oh, my gosh. Yes, it's me. But tonight I've come to redeem myself. I have one song in my head, one song in my hand. I'm ready. When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the saved on earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. Yeah.
I'm just going to say that, you know, Christians, like Brother Jeff said a while ago, they go through a lot of different things. You know, they do. But one thing about it, you lay down at night, or if you go out of here before you even think, you're not even expecting to leave this world. God said he'd take care of us. He said, I'll never leave you and I'll never forsake you. He'll be right there with us. And it don't matter what goes on in this life. Let me tell you this, one thing about it. Heaven's going to be our home one day, and I thank God for that. And we don't have to go to a place called hell. And so many people, their eyes are blinded right now. And I just pray, the Lord open their eyes, because I've got family that don't know the Lord right now. But one of these days, I believe they will, and I believe it's going to be soon. So, but Jesus is coming soon. So, I think it's probably... Coming soon, Jesus in all his glory, not just the Savior, but a reigning King. Coming soon, and the whole world. She's getting it. I was thinking about Sister Margaret and all of them here at the WLJC at the TV station. You know, we really don't realize what a job it is, you know, to be here every night and be here the day and answer phone calls and all this. But I appreciate them, and I mean that with all my heart. And everybody just needs to get in and do what they can, and bless them. We praise you.
Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, how great thou art.
All right. Thank you for all those good songs. The House of Prayer Singers from Moorhead, Kentucky. And we've enjoyed that, and now we're going to enjoy the pastors from that church, and we're just going to turn them loose here and let them go till we're about out of time, and then they'll warn us, and just before we run out of time, well, we'll have to stop. But let's just welcome the preaching for the first night of our fall revival.
Praise God. Sister Margaret, we counted the privilege to be here at WLJC. A lot of people don't realize how important this station is to all around, not only our country, but across the world. It's very important. And there's something that we never hear much of. There's going to be the last broadcast ever made from this stage, from this studio. There'll never be another one. And if you pass up that one, the next thing you're going to hear, the trumpet that we was talking about here, he said he's coming on the sound of a trumpet. And he's coming after those that have accepted him and is willing to work for him. And folks, it's more than just shaking a preacher's hand. It takes the blood of Jesus being applied to your life if you are going to make it to the city of God. Because a lot of people are saying there's many ways that get to God. No, Acts 4 and 12 said there's no other name given under heaven but by Jesus Christ, whereby we may be saved. And I don't know about you, I want the genuine. We got imitations. We got a lot of things. And around our Brother Joe is a chief deputy, and he finds out a lot of times they have imitations at the sales where they've got booths set up. And they'll have a big name on it, but it will be an imitation. Right. Now, you can do a lot of things, but I want to tell you something. This word of God says, by a tree, there is known by their fruit. Yes. Not by their leaves, by their fruit. Right. And if we've got fruits of righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost, and we're trying to help somebody that is lost and dying and going to hell, I thought about this. The Master said that he had made a great supper, and he bid his servant to go out and invite people to come to that supper. He said, it's a great supper. And the first one, I believe, that he talked to, he said, I've bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I pray have me excused. I've got to go check them. The other one said, well, I can't go. I bought a piece of ground. I've got to go look at it. And the third one didn't even make an excuse. Said, I've married a wife, therefore, and I can't come. So he returns back to the servant, returns to his master. How we done? He said, we got 0. He said, well, go get the blind, the halt, the lame, and all of those. And he come back and said, how are we done? He said, ain't done no good, Master. Now, here's the day that we're in. Devil might tell you that you ain't the mountain to nothing. He might try to tell you that you'll never mount to anything. But I want to tell you something. You can be a son or a daughter of God by accepting the blood of Jesus. And you can go to be with Jesus while the ages roll on. And everybody that doesn't accept the Lord Jesus Christ, it's a free gift. And it doesn't cost you but one thing, giving up the world for Jesus. Which is the best? Having a hangover, head throbbing, and worrying what you done last night, you didn't know where it happened, this has happened. And if you get over, we have in the Bible where that they did accuse them of being drunk. And Peter said, these are not drunk as you suppose, seeing this it, but the third hour of the day. And this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel, saying the last days he will pour out his spirit on all flesh. This is what you're looking at. Now Joel tells us that we're going to have another revival back here. And he said, the latter rain is going to be greater than the former rain. And the Master said, I have a supper, and I bid them to come. It doesn't make any difference what you've done, what you've been into, he will forgive you. I know people will try to maybe hold it against you, but you know what to do? Say, I'm sorry. You'll have to go to the pond that he said that is not to be touched in the bottom because it's a sea of forgetfulness. Yes. Too deep for you to take anything to get into. And your sins, he said, though they be as scarlet, I'll wash them and wash you and make them white like wool. And when we come to him and Jesus washes us, we become a brand new creature in Christ. We're no longer the old thing. We don't, you know, somebody said, well, what about the, you won't want to do them old things. You've got a lot better things to do. Somebody said, the devil said to my wife, said, you can't have no fun when we'd been backslid for 16 years. She said, fun? I said, you stupid thing, I wasn't having fun. We was on the verge of divorce and we wasn't having no fun at all. And said, now I've just changed partners. I'm going to dance right on. And she did. She danced for the Lord. You don't have to quit dancing. David danced with all of his might. He didn't please his wife. But you know what? She got after David and knew what God done. And in that day, this was been a reproach against a wife to not have children. God shut her womb up. Wouldn't let her have no children. And David said, I'm going to do worse than this. He was bringing the Ark of the Covenant back. Because David, every six paces, he would stop and offer sacrifice. And he knew that if that Ark of the Covenant get back, they'd have God there. We know if we get Jesus in the picture, then we've got everything all right. We've got things that we can make everything all right. It may look black, it may look dark, but folks, call in them lines. Call in them. And preachers, you get behind this TV station. Because this TV station helps us. They're not here against us. I want to tell you what Jesus said. He had the apostles. And they, some of them kind of got high-minded. And there was another group over here was casting out devils and was getting the sick healed. And they forbid them. And he told Jesus, said, Master, they wouldn't pay no attention to us. They just kept right on. He said, boys, don't you realize that if they're not against us, they're for us? And he said, there's more than you, but there's more than one fish in the pond. And when you think that you're the only thing that God can use, you've got another thing coming. I'll tell you what he done. He had a prophet. I'm talking about a prophet, a genuine prophet, Balaam. And the mule run him into the cliff because the mule had better sight than he did. The mule saw the angel with a sword and was going to kill him. And the mule began to talk to Balaam. And Balaam, it never says that he recognized what he's done, but he was talking back to the mule. She said, have I ever done you wrong, Master? No, you raised me from a colt. And he saw the angel and seen. So it took a mule to get his attention. What's it going to take to get your attention?
Yes. Amen. That's right. Jesus. All right. I'm going to jump in here. Brother Winston and I, on occasions, we call tag team. We're going to tag team preach a little bit. And I'm just excited to be here. I'm excited for revival. A lot of times it's the words, of course, but revival. But I like the word awakening. I think we need to be awakened. And I believe God's trying to get our attention to tell us it's time to the church, the Lord Jesus Christ, be awake. You know, Jesus went to pray, and he took his disciples with him. And as he went a little further, he took his little inner circle, Peter, James, and John. And Jesus was earnestly praying in the garden, and he came back, and he found them asleep. And he said, watch and pray, watch and pray. He went back and prayed more, and he came back, and they were still slumbering, they were sleeping. And he said, can't you even pray and watch? Don't you see what's going on? There was a great distress going on at that particular time. You know, the sin of the world was getting ready to be placed on Jesus. And he understood what was getting ready to happen. And it's time for the church right now to understand what's happening, what's getting ready to happen. You know, if I had to title this, I would title it Excited But Concerning. You know, we can be excited. If we're in the body of Christ, it's exciting times because we're literally seeing the Word of God being fulfilled right before our eyes. We don't have to make anything fit. All we have to do is read the Scripture. I've been reading Scripture for years from Sunday school. My Sunday school teacher was teaching me this years ago. And a lot of people, and then the Bible said there'll be scoffers. There'll be people say, well, where's the promise of His coming? The way I look at it this way, I'm watching and waiting for His appearance, just like He told His disciples. He told people throughout the ages, you watch and you wait for me to appear. He said, I'm going to appear the second time for those who are watching and waiting for them to appear, number one. And, well, do you think He could come today or tomorrow? Absolutely, He could come today or tomorrow. And you know what? If He don't come today or tomorrow, I'll be watching for Him the next day.
Amen.
I'm going to be watching and waiting because that is my job, and I believe that's the job of every person that has accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior. They're a watchman. They're a watch person up on the wall. Nehemiah, they were building the wall, and as they were building the wall, they were working with one hand, but you know what they had in the other hand? They had their sword. And they were ready for the enemy, but they were also working. Jesus told us, He said, occupy till I come.
Amen.
Occupy means you stay busy, you do the system that has been set up and you work and you continue to do. The best way I've heard it said is, you work every day or you prepare every day as Jesus is coming any moment, but you plan for the future.
Amen.
You go ahead and you make plans, you make preparations. And again, people will say, and I refer to them as the Bible said, they're scoffers. Well, when's He coming? And what about this? And you're all building churches and you're all building these big buildings. If you think you're saying Jesus is coming, why are you building these things? You know, we're doing exactly what He told us to do. We're occupying until He comes. We're staying busy and we're doing the work of the witness. We're doing the Great Commission. We're going out and we're helping to bring others into the kingdom of God. Yes, He could appear and He will, just like He said He would. Folks, He is coming. He may not be today, it may be tomorrow, and it might, but He's still coming. If He don't come, when we think He's coming, that's when He'll come. He said, no man knows the day nor the hour. I like what one minister said as he was talking about Jesus. He said, not even Jesus knowing the day or the hour, because Jesus said, not the angels, my Father only is the one that knows when the day and the hour. But one minister said it like this. He said, Jesus referred in the Scriptures. He said, I told and spoke everything my Father said. He said, if the Father told Him when He was coming, Jesus would have told us, because He spoke everything the Father told Him to speak.
Amen.
So, Father reserved that. Our Heavenly Father reserved that for Him to say, Son, it's time. Go bring them home. Go get them. Let me read the Scripture in 1 Chronicles 12 and 32. It says, the children of Issachar, which were men that had understanding of the times, knowing or discerning the times, to know what Israel ought to do, the heads of them that were 200 and all their brethren were at their commandment. You know, and some will say, well, he's speaking about Israel. But you got to understand something. There's a natural principle, but also there's a spiritual principle. We got to understand who we are in Christ Jesus. See, Christ Jesus came and fulfilled all these things. That's why we can say there's only two nations on the face of the earth that are founded by God on the Word of God and been put under the mandates of God. And that's the United States and it's the country of Israel. We're wearing the tallits. We blow the shofar. I believe in Acts, the book of Acts tells us, he said, there's going to be a restoration of all things. And we want to know everything there is to know that God wants us to know. He's put it out here for us. He said, my people perish for what? A lack of knowledge. A lack of knowledge. We've got to study. I've heard it said like this and said it for a long time. You get in the Word, and the Word will get into you. And you can, and it's amazing what God will reveal to you.
Amen.
It's by revelation. The Holy Spirit dwells within us. He comes in and He gives us revelation. And that's what we have to be like the sons of Issachar. We have to be discerning of the times and knowing, because the church, you know, expects people to be on our level of understanding and knowing what the Word of God says. But you know what? They don't. And there's a lot of Christians that don't know or don't understand. Now, we don't know it all. I'm not saying that. I'm not trying to be arrogant or trying to be boastful about this. But when you study the Word and God reveals things, He said, surely, He said, I'm not going to do nothing or I'm not going to spring anything on unless I reveal it unto my prophets, my servant, the prophets. God's not going to let something sneak up on us that's bad for us. If we're watching and we're waiting and we're praying and we're close to God, and I'm not talking about knowing about Him, I'm talking about knowing Him. I'm talking about having a relationship, amen, a personal, one-on-one relationship to where when you walk into your prayer closet or you kneel down and pray, you feel the presence of God. If you don't, when Elijah was hearing from God, he said he didn't come in a fire. He didn't come in the wind. He didn't come in the earthquake, but he came in a still, small voice. Mm-hmm. And if we're going to hear a still, small voice, you know what we've got to do? We've got to be close, and we've got to be listening.
Amen.
It's what we talked about the other day at church. We said when we pray earnestly. We pray and believe, and faith believing that God is the answer that answers our prayers. He says, if you ask and you faith believe, ask me, and he says, I will do it for you. But here's the other part of that. There's a part B to that. It's when you get through praying, a lot of times we just get up and go and we don't listen for God to speak to us.
Yeah.
It's time to pause, pray, and when we're done praying, when we're done speaking to Him, whether we're asking Him for something or we're just on our knees thanking You, Lord. Thank You for being there for me. Thank You for blessing me. Thank You for taking care of me each and every day. And then all at once, we just need to kind of be quiet,
yes,
and listen for that still small voice. Because a lot of times, if we're not careful, we'll just jump up after we get through praying because there's so much going on, so much distractions. We're in a hurry. And how many times, and I believe I said it here last time, don't try to find time for the Lord. You make time for the Lord. You know why? Because He made time for you. He made time for me. He put everything aside in heaven and He said, I'm going. He said, I'll go to earth and I'll be the one that can redeem man back to the Father, where he can have a relationship. Adam lost it in the garden. Eve lost it in the garden. They lost the personal. When God came down in the cool of the day, you think about it, God came down and wanted to spend time with His creation. He wanted fellowship. He wanted communication. That's what you're created for. That's what I was created for, is to have a relationship. Yeah, some people in the world calls it a religion. Christianity's titled a religion. I differ with that. It's not a religion, it's a relationship.
Amen.
We've got to have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Somebody said one time, told this guy, he said, you pray, when you pray just like you know who you're speaking to. He said, oh, I do. I don't know about Him. And there's a difference. Somebody can know something about me, but you know, they may not know me. But you know what? You have to have that type of relationship with Jesus Christ. You don't need to know about Him. You don't need to tell somebody about Him. You need to tell somebody just exactly how He is, because you know how He is when you have that intimate personal relationship with Him. When you can come in and you can have a conversation, He can speak to you and you speak to Him and you talk to Him each and every day. You wake up in the morning, you say, thank You, Lord, for another day. You end the day by saying, Lord, thank You for giving me another day. Thank You for a good night's rest when you wake up in the morning. Lord, thank You for helping me through this day. Thank You for blessing me. Thank You for everything You've done, because, church, He's worth it. He's worth every praise that we can give Him.
Amen.
Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. We are the watchmen. Yes, concerning, but excited. Excited to know what's going to be next. We need to be concerned for our loved ones and family and friends, and there's people out here that are lost and they're dying. Sister Margaret, we've got this heroin epidemic. I thought about the souls that had entered eternity just by putting that substance in them, feeling a false high that the devil has got them so blinded, and you know, but there's scripture for that. Revelation chapter 18. It says, by sorceries, all nations were deceived. By sorceries. Now, do a word study on sorceries. Look it up in the Greek. If you want to look it up, and I'll just tell you, I may not be pronouncing it just right, but I pronounce it pharmakia or pharmakia. Pharmakia is where we get our word pharmacy from. Don't we know that that's all that drug is a deceiving? It's a deception out there. What's the devil's put out there. They said, this is the high. Well, listen, you don't know the high until you know the most holy high.
Amen.
And that's Jesus Christ. That's, if you want to get high, that's the way to get high. Because He can take you higher than you've ever been. He can bless you so you just don't know. You know, and some of you may be in a situation, you know, that you've turned this on, and you're in addicted to some of the substances that we're talking about. But you know what? If you turn to Jesus Christ, I guarantee it, you will never want to turn back. Because He is the Most High. He's the one that can take you and clean you and put your feet set solid on the ground and get you beyond wanting something that's going to destroy you. Jesus isn't in the destroying business. He's in the uplifting and the everlasting life business. Satan, St. John 10:10, the thief not come, but to kill, steal, and destroy. And I'm glad that the scripture didn't stop there, Brother Winston. Mm-mm. It says, but Jesus is saying this, I have come that you may have life and have that life more abundant.
Amen.
And I'm so thankful for that. I'm so thankful that He came and laid down His life. No man took it. He willingly laid it down on the cross. 3 days He spent in the heart of the earth. And on the third day, He did exactly what He said He would do. He arose from the grave, and He gave us victory over death, hell, and the grave.
Amen.
We know without a doubt, you know, even the psalmist knew this, David, when he wrote the 23rd Psalm, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. You know, and that's the same scripture that I read at the cemetery when we're getting ready to put somebody's earthly tabernacle, their body, into the ground. I read that, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. See, when you're a child of God, when you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, only thing death can do is cast a shadow. That's all death can do. And see, we know to be absent from the body, according to the Word, is what? To be present
with the Lord.
Yes. And you know, there's going to be a great gathering. There's going to be a great homecoming. And it's coming soon. But what I want to impress upon everyone, and I believe this is a right now, this is a word for right now, this is what the Lord gave me to speak and say, is we got to be the watchman. We're the one that's warning. We're the one that's telling people Jesus is coming. There's things that's taking place now. You know, just like Luke talked about it, I believe it was Luke 21:25. It says, and there'll be signs in the sun, the moon, the stars. There'll be distress in nation, perplexities, seas and the waves roaring. Did we have some seas and waves roaring this past week in this hurricane? And it goes on to say, it says, hearts of men failing them for the fear of what's coming upon them. And I believe it was the first death that we had heard reported was someone had a heart attack.
Yeah.
Hearts failing them.
Yeah.
That's what the scripture said.
Yes.
Seas and the waves roaring. It said there'll be earthquakes in different or diverse places. King James used diverse, but that means different places. Do you know at the same time the hurricane was going on that the people around the Los Angeles area, around the San Andreas Fault area, was put on an earthquake watch because there was seismic activity going on? I read that. And I'm going, my goodness, what signs, what he's showing. He's saying we see the waves roaring on one coast, an earthquake watch on the other coast. It's time for us to watch and wait. It's time for us to wake up. It's time for us to sound the alarm. You know, the shofar, as Brother Winston blew it during that song. You know, the shofar was used at one time. There's four blasts on there. One of those blasts is called the awakening. To wake up, to gather together, to assemble together, whether it was for war, whether it was gathering assembly because there's an announcement needed to be made, whether it was to start a service, but it was also to watch and to warn. If there was a watchman on the wall and he seen trouble coming, the shofar was blown. We blow that shofar to let people know that the enemy's there, and the enemy's at hand. But you know, I can't stop there. And I'm going to say this, and I'm going to let Brother Winston kind of finish this up. But what I want to say is, this is not a doom and gloom message. This is not something that you know, judgment is coming, even though it is. This is not, if you take it as a doom and gloom, you're missing the point. And remember this, it's only doom and gloom if you're not on the right side. You know what the right side is? It's on the Jesus Christ side.
Right.
If you're living out from under, as Brother Winston said, the blood of Jesus Christ, if you're not saved and you don't have the blood applied, it is a very, very concerning time. I've heard people say, I'm afraid. They used the word afraid. They've used the word fear. They've used those words to me. Aren't you afraid? Aren't you fearful? I say, absolutely not. Why not? I said, number one, I know what's coming. I know, because I read the Word of God. I know what's coming, number one. And number two, I know a way out. I know, hey, we may have to go through things, but you know what? Jesus will take a hold and lead us through. He'll do that.
Amen.
He said He would. But the good news is the good news. You know what the good news is? It's the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
If you got Jesus Christ in your life, what peace you have when you lay down at night. If your eyes never open again, the next time they do open, you can say, good morning, Lord. If they don't, if they open again on this side of eternity, you can say, Lord, thank you for a good night's rest and lead me through this day. And the other part of it is the simplicity of the gospel. How simple it is to be saved. Jesus made it that way. It says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Well, I don't know any big prayers, or I don't know what words to say, or I don't know what to speak to get His attention. You know what to get His attention? You can say, help me, Lord. Lord, I need You. You use His name in a reverent way, Lord. Not in vain, but you use it in a reverence way, saying, Lord, I don't know. You help me. I'm sorry for what I've done. Please forgive me. I'm calling on to You. I'm tired of living this sinful life, or I'm tired of living a life of addiction. I'm tired of doing the worldly things. What I want to do is I want to live for You the rest of my life.
Amen.
That's how simple the gospel is. That's how simple it is to be saved. And know for sure that if you don't wake up tonight, because we're not promised tomorrow, none of us, not the next breath we take is promised to us. Any of us could leave here at any time. We've seen the youngest to the oldest in the funeral homes. Death has no boundaries. But you know what? Jesus Christ overcame death.
Amen.
And therefore, we can have eternal life through the Lord Jesus Christ. Please repent. Please ask Jesus Christ into your heart. He'll save you.
Amen.
And He'll bless you from that point on. And you can, and the other blessing is you get to work for the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Whatever occupation you're in, you get promoted. You get to work for the kingdom now. And it's the greatest life you'll ever live.
Amen.
It's like Brother Winston was talking about our sister Jerry and how somebody told her that it's not fun being a Christian. Let me tell you something. It's the funnest, best, most enjoyable time I've ever had in my life. You know what? I thought I was having fun when I wasn't saved. I was believing the lie. I was believing the deception. I was believing what the world was telling me out here. But you know what? That world does nothing but lead you into a life of destruction.
Amen.
But Jesus Christ came and He said to give us life and have that life more abundant.
Right.
Brother Winston.
David's two men in the Bible went to pray. And this one was a Pharisee. And he said, I thank God I'm not like this skunk here.
Come on.
I pay my tithes and I fast twice a week. I'm not like him. That's judgmental. You know what Jesus said about that man? He said that man was smote his breast and said, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. And he said, I tell you, that man went to his house justified and the other one didn't. Now, folks, it's not on what you're trying to put on, trying to show the dog. I'm going to tell you something. We're facing something. We're going to find out who the genuine is and who the hypocrites is. And these hypocrites out there don't think they ain't. Because I was in the world, and me and my wife went to courted together, and you couldn't, when we courted back in, we've been married 62 years, you couldn't go nowhere but church. And we went to church and got in church, and we got in a bad kind of a church. It was not a church. And for 9 months, we didn't know nothing until come to me and told me what they was done, and said, yeah, we want you all, you've been here long enough. And my wife said, you getting ready to go to church? It was on a Sunday evening. I said, no. She said, why? I said, I'm not going to that church. She said, why? I said, I want to know why. Well, I told her. She said, well, I don't blame you. She said, I'm not either. So for 16 years, we backslid. We had 170-acre dairy farm. We had a brand new house. We had cattle and dairy herds, and we had wagons and tractors and trucks and everything that a young couple would want. But I got the gambling, drinking, and went away from God, and I've been to the bottom, so I know what you feel like. I've been there to where we had to count our change between us to buy a cheeseburger, fries, and a Coke. Now, folks, I've been there, and I think the reason why I didn't have, God didn't have to send me there, but I think he let us go there so we could help you. You're hurting, and people's looking down on you, and some of you can't help it. Some of you in bad shape. The devil's got you in bad shape. We want you to come. We invite you to come. And we've got Brother Tommy Bates coming to our church the 21st of this month on a Friday night at the House of Prayer, 600 Whispering Oaks Road, Moorhead, Kentucky. You come. Somebody said, how do I need to put a suit or something? Hey, you can dress up a harlot, and they're still a harlot. You can dress up a hypocrite, he's still a hypocrite. If you've got clothed in modest apparel, that means to hide your nakedness. Now, if you want to know the interpretation for that. And it's not in the dress. That's not it. Because I want to tell you something. I watched people, and I seen people, and they had long sleeves, long hair, and a long tongue to go with it. And folks, these people deceiving people, and they're deceived themselves. And I want to send this out. We got people in Florida, people in Alabama, and Georgia, and all over the place that we're sending this out to, and a lot of our brothers and sisters. I ain't going to start naming because I'll forget some. And every one of you, we love you, and we appreciate you, and we appreciate most of all you standing behind this TV station and backing Sister Margaret up. Church, we back this place up. We don't boast about it, but we do it. Not only with prayers, but we back them up with money. Because it takes an awful lot of money to keep this thing opening. And this may be the very last chance that we're going to have to get the gospel out. If the wrong kind of people gets in, we're going to be in trouble. And you better pray and say, well, I want to help this. Let me tell you plain. If you vote for a baby killer, you're a baby killer. Now, is that too plain for you? Now, you better be careful how you vote if you claim to be a Christian. That book said, don't be partakers of other man's sins. And now, Brother Joe is a police officer. If I give a man a gun and he uses it to kill somebody with, am I involved? I'm accessory to the fact. Is that right? Mm-hmm. Now, folks, I'm going to tell you something. You better be very careful. The last election, 45 million Christians did not vote. That's a privilege that God gave you. And the reason why we're in the shape we're in, nobody would want to step up to the plate and try to make a change. Let's see if we can't fix this thing till our babies. I want to tell you something. I don't want some kook going into my great-granddaughter's dressing room because they say that they're this today or they're that today. I'll tell you what to do. Raise the hood and take a look and you'll see what they are. It's not hard to see what they are. They may claim this or they may claim that, but I'll tell you one thing. I'd use this on one right quick. Somebody said, preacher, you're supposed to be a preacher. Brother Perry Fred Stone, he said, they said, preacher, you mean you don't believe in the Holy Ghost? He said, yes, sir, I believe in the Holy Ghost. I've had it for several years. Well, why are you talking like that? He said, in case he don't show up, I've got a 38 Smith & Wesson that will show up. And folks, I'm going to tell you something. We're living in perilous times and dangerous times, and you better, if you've got loved ones that's lost, you better try to get them in. Mm-hmm. Quit trying to be a hypocrite before them, and if you ain't living right, repent. Mm-hmm. that it?
Yes. Yes. Well, that's very good. That is so true. What you've been hearing is just plain talk. Plain talk's easy understood, I've always thought. And it doesn't take Einstein to understand that. And there's just so much, we'll go right back to the decisions that we make.
Amen.
You know, talking about all this drug epidemic and everything, and how that people, you can choose to go with the wrong crowd, and or you can choose to pick somebody else to go with. And all right, well, here's a good Joe. You want to read that since you, Brother Winston saving his eyesight tonight, so.
Yes.
All right, you want to read?
Yes, it's salvation and praise that is called in by Matthew. Matthew was at his lowest point when he turned on WLJC, and it pricked his heart, and he gave his heart to Jesus.
Praise God.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. The greatest
decision you ever made, Matthew.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
You find you a good church that believes in teaching the Bible, teaching the true Word of God, and you get dug in, and you'll be blessed.
Folks, Jesus didn't say, go and tell them that you have the greatest church. He said, preach the kingdom of heaven. That's what he said to do. We're supposed to be on business for a king. We're not supposed, we've got churches. We've got a wonderful church. Debt free, God's blessed us. But we don't look at that church and say, I want you to look what we have. No, it's what God has allowed us to have. And it's people by paying their tithes. And if you don't believe in paying tithes, you don't believe in going to heaven. We had Brother Jesse Duplantis's baby brother with us. There was a couple up front wanted to be prayed for. He asked them plain straight out. I never had nobody do that. He said, do you folks pay tithes? No, sir. Said, we don't. We put money here and we put there. He said, let me tell you something. I'm not going to pray for a thief. What do you mean? He said, if you don't pay your tithes, you're a thief. That belongs to God. And if you claim this to be your church, you should be sending Sister Margaret and them 10% of whatever you got. You see, Malachi chapter 3 says, if you want to see the windows of heaven open, you do that, and God will open the windows of heaven. I'd wish I had $20,000, I'd sure do it. No, you won't. You won't pay on a dime, you stingy saint. You wouldn't pay on $20,000. Listen, folks. This goes back before when Abraham in the 12th chapter of the book of Genesis, when Abraham took 318 servants that he raised in his own household, and they robbed Lot and took all of his goods, five kings. Now think about five kings. And this one man, this one godly man, went back and whooped the socks out of them and got everything that they had. And on his way back, he met Melchizedek. He brought bread and wine, and Abraham paid him a tenth of everything that he had. Oh, that's not low. Now, you want to find something red, you don't like this, but I'm going to tell you, Matthew 23:23. They asked Jesus, what do you think, Master, about paying tithes? Well, he said, you pay tithes of mint and anise and cumin, and you have left the weightier matters of the tithing law undone. Judgment, mercy, and faith. You ought to done them and not left the others undone. You ought to do that. And if you don't like that, read the 7th chapter of the book of Hebrews. You'll find that it tells you about all of this. And God gave us, and I know a brother, he's dead and gone now, Brother Colonel Sanders. I saw his testimony. He started off and he was going to kill himself. His wife said, Colonel, you're the best chicken cooker ever was. Said, why don't you try and send them around to the factories here and see? He started, and the first thing you know, he had to open up a chicken place. Well, Brother Bob Rogers' daddy got him saved. And he said on this program, he said, I started giving God 10%. He said, I'm now giving him 90% and I can't spend a dime. Try God, won't you try God? He's got a lot bigger hand than you have. And he ain't got no depression in heaven. There ain't no compression and none of them things. And you know what? If you want to be blessed, I found out how to get blessed. Get God's attention and let him know that you believe what the word says. This is to bless you. It's not to hurt you. This is to bless you. I want to see you blessed. Our people is blessed because you know why? They're driving good automobiles. They've got good jobs because they put God where he ought to be. And somebody said, I don't know, I'm having an awful rough time. The Bible says the way of a transgressor is hard too. But listen, folks, this station needs to be promoted. Pastors, you need to get behind this station because I'm going to tell you something. They can go places that we can't go. That's right. They can touch hearts and lives that we can't go. And when we get to heaven and we see the souls that has come in, they'll say, you had a part in that. God is one of the first in network marketing that there was. Because we have in Turkey, we have, I will not name the name, but we have an evangelist there. He was back last year. I said, how many churches we got, brother? He said, 53. We've got 53 churches that we're having fruit for our congregation from. Now, we got a church in India. It's not a fancy church. We got, or did have one in Guatemala. I don't know where we got it now or not since this storm. But folks, the signs is here. As Brother Joe said, men's hearts failing them seeing what's coming upon the earth. If you get your arms in Jesus' arms and you get your sins under the blood, it won't bother you. But if you don't get your sins under the blood, you'll pull your hair, you'll toss all night. It's good to lay down and just sleep like a baby, knowing that if he comes, you're going. And folks, I'll tell you, it wasn't all the time that way. When I was backslid, there was many of a night that I dreaded to lay down because I knowed that where I'd go. If I hadn't a God come to me on a Saturday morning out in the woods, been backslid 16 years, and my cousin told me, he was cutting timber, he said, there's some ginseng over there. Well, I went over there, and I started down in the woods, and, hey, Winston. I said, yeah, Clayton. Well, the next time, the voice was right by my side. He said, Winston, this is the last call you will get. He said, there's a revival starting Monday night over at a Free Will Baptist Church. He said, I want you and your wife, and there was another man to go, and Friday night I want you to go to the altar. I'll tell you what he's going to be preaching on. He's going to preach on the 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Well, I got there, and I was addicted. I didn't smoke one or two. I smoked four packs of them cigarillos a day and three or four or five Schweizer cigars. And I really done it good. I smoked one in and chewed the other. And you know what? I went that night and God detoxed me. My wife, I didn't know that she was, when I raised up, we was both together. And that's been over 44 years ago. And he's never been back to try to tempt me with that because he knows that's under the blood. And you can get it under the blood too.
Yes, that is true. And some of the folk that are struggling so with drugs, they think that not anything can break that crave they have, but it can.
Yes,
so we definitely need to pray for that. We have a number of requests. Here's someone that's having surgery, and if they cannot get a stent put in, said she's not going to make it because she's septic. And so they're just different ones. People with a little five-year-old with a brain cancer, and just real serious request. And so we're going to ask these two ministers to anoint these and pray over it, and let's put that little girl that got saved tonight, put her in there too, because that's wonderful. That's our first salvation report for the revival. And you've heard so much good gospel here tonight. That was the first before service started tonight. So go ahead.
Father, we come in the precious name of Jesus, and we pray over these. And Father, you touch each and every one, supply all their need according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. And Lord, we thank you and we praise you for mercy and for goodness. We thank you for what you've done and what you are doing. Thank you for allowing us to be here. And Lord, ask you to bless Sister Margaret and them through this revival. Let souls be harvested. And we can see them together in heaven one of these days before long. In Jesus' precious name.
Hallelujah. All right. Very, very good. All right. Would y'all like to tell about where your church is located? Because, you know, each time we have a service, each night, while we have new people that, so tell them where the church is and your services.
We're about 3.5 miles out of Moorhead. If you come on I-64, it's exit 133. And then you turn south on 801 to Whispering Oaks, 600 Whispering Oaks, the House of Prayer Incorporated. And if you come from Lexington, you turn right. And Pastor Tommy Bates will be there the 21st of this month, and you're invited to come, and he's planning on bringing 40 of their youth with him. So we're going to have a time. The last time he was there, and he didn't come. He came on Tuesday night. They didn't get to come. And they said, Pastor, you can't do that no more on us. You got to let us go with you. And we thank God that Sister Margaret and Brother Don's been there homecoming with us, and they sneaked up and had me a birthday party, and they had it 2 or 3 days ahead of times. I said, I ain't claiming it. I said, I ain't that old yet. I said, I'm holding my own until time runs out. But we love you, and come and be with us. And if we've got a lot of people that's come, and if you believe, see, there's a lot of things that people do not tell you that's in this book that Brother Joe was talking about. There's gifts in there for us. There's things to help you, armor to put on. And God is a wonderful God.
Amen, brother.
And He will never leave you, and He'll never forsake you.
Amen.
All right.
Brenda from Morgan County, actually rededication, has rededicated her life to the Lord. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord.
So we're starting off tonight with the blessing of the Lord. Three souls. And
Amen.
So
Amen.
If Jesus said one soul's worth the whole world, well, then that's, that's more than three worlds. But anyway, we appreciate so much these folk coming and all the good messages that you have heard. And we do hope that you will pay attention and you can make the decision right there in your own home or hospital room or jail cell or wherever you are. Mm-hmm. It's the thing that we want you to do is to have this personal relationship with
Amen.
The Lord. Yeah, that's the only thing that's going to get you through. You know, sometimes we encourage people to not wait till they can call somebody to expect the Lord to be with them, because somebody else can't be with you all the time, but God can.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit can. So anyway, well, we have a couple of minutes. Brother Winston, do you want to mention about your surgery coming up?
And well, if God don't heal me the 21st, 26th, he said, thank you, hon. 26th, I'm supposed to have hip replacement, but I'm looking for God to do it before then, because his rehab is a lot more and a lot quicker.
And easier.
And it's a lot easier. His physical therapy, I don't have to go through that.
Yeah. Okay.
But I thought of something. Brother E.V. Hill was a black preacher. Mm-hmm. And he was on Trinity Broadcasting for years. And he'd look up towards heaven and say, Mama, he said, could you believe a boy raised in a little log cabin could be here? And he was in Jerusalem with a bunch of people. And he got separated off, and he started to go back. He looked at something, and they wasn't going to let him in. And the guide said, he's with us. You know what he done? He said, I'm with Jesus. Now, if you're with Jesus, you get to go in. If we're with him, we can go in. But if we ain't with Jesus, he's going to say, depart from me. And somebody said, I don't know about this. I can't live it. No, sir, you cannot. I'll tell you right flat off, you can't do it. If there had been a law where we could have been saved, the law would have made.
All right. Well, we're out of time. So from all of us here, we want to say good night and God bless you.
Thank you for being a part of the Hour of Harvest. We hope you get a blessing every time you watch. This program is available for download on your computer or mobile device at www.wljc.com. WLJC is now available on Roku and Google TV. DVD copies of this program are also available for your contribution of $15 or more. The WLJC programs, including the Hour of Harvest, are brought to you through your contributions of support. All contributions made to WLJC are eligible for income tax deduction. Thanks to all who support us. Without you, our programming would not be possible. If you would like to join our mailing list to receive our free monthly newsletter to keep you informed about what is happening at WLJC, along with our monthly musical guest schedule, call 606-464-3600 or write to WLJC, P.O. Box Y, Beattyville, Kentucky, 41311. Want to hear from us faster? Join our email mailing list. You can sign up at wljc.com. It's easy and it's free. May God bless you.